Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here, and I'm so glad that so many people have turned up. You should have said that I could talk about neuropsychology, because I would have loved that. But it's another subject today, and a very important subject, actually. I called it Beyond a Biomedical and Social Model of Disability, Outline of a Cultural Historical Model of Disability. And at this point, it could be important to ask, why all these models? Can't we just go out and do some practice? But the model is what actually make us do different things. As I will come around in my talk, so models are so important because they guide what we go out and do, even when we're not aware of what type of model we are applying. The currently most influential model of disability is the one from the World Health Organization. This one. This model states that disability is an umbrella term that covers a complex phenomenon that reflects the interaction between, on one side, the individual body, its functions and functionalities, and on the other hand, the society. In doing this, this definition actually incorporates ideas from two opposing models of disability, the medical model and the social model. While this model from the World Health Organization incorporates all the important elements that are related to understanding disability, it actually, according to me, and I will explain as we go along why I think so, according to me, it lacks concepts that explains the relationship between all the different elements in this model. I find that cultural historical theory offers us a conceptual understanding that can take us much further in understanding what disability is and how having an impairment affects your life and developmental opportunities. However, before I turn to the cultural historical model, I would like to say a few words about these two opposing models, the social model and the medical model. There might be some who are not familiar necessarily with the model, but you might actually, as I mentioned what is in the models, think that you have come across them before, because they are so much part of our everyday life. People use them when they encounter people with disabilities or work with people with disabilities. First, the medical model. It is not an explicitly described model. It is actually a label that has been attached to a number of different studies that have this in common, that they work from a mainly individual and biomedical approach. In this biomedical approach, disability is mainly considered as caused by a biological impairment. The strength of the biomedical model is that it offered a very nuanced and rich conceptual framework for understanding the biological impairment and the relationship between specific impairments and how they impact on individual functional skills. So you can say the medical model has an important role in the fact that it has actually guided research and the development of treatment and cures for a lot of impairments. The main shortcoming of the biomedical model is that disability is overall considered as an individual problem. So an emerging group of activists and critical social scientists express their dissatisfaction with this approach and the lack of attention to the social aspects of disability. So the other model, the social model, was developed in opposition to this beforehand dominating biomedical approach. It started out in Great Britain in the 1960s and 1970s, but since then it has disseminated globally. Even when I go to conferences in disability from a biomedical approach, the social model is lying underneath all of them. There's no one who's really a clear-cut working in the biomedical model anymore. So the social model has completely disseminated globally. The central idea of this social model is that the main causal factor in disability is not the physical impairment or the biological impairment. It is because society fails to take individual differences into account. It fails to see how disability is a social barrier and disability is a social oppression of particular groups, for example, wheelchair users. It was like a revolution when this model came out first. It was experienced as very empowering because while disability had earlier been like a very personal problem that could be associated with shame, it was now a group problem. It was a group being discriminated, and it was the responsibility of the society to actually enable this group to participate. So the social model accentuates a completely different aspect of disability. It accentuates the central role of legal, societal, and social factors, and how they cause barriers to equal social participation of children and adults with disability. This model has also been criticized in its pure form, mainly for ignoring that there is something biomedical about disability. It could be like the experience of pain, for example. You cannot take pain away with so many removal of social barriers. So what is needed is a theory of disability that incorporates elements from both the biomedical and the social model of disability, and how these two aspects together create a social situation of development for the person, be it a child or adolescent or adult with disability. Furthermore, persons with disabilities share many similarities with people in general, and we need to include this relation between the general and the specific in our conceptual understanding of how children, adolescents, and adults with disability develop. Not in a normative way, not as something to compare with or compensate towards, but in an analytical way of understanding what disability is about. The cultural historical understanding of the development of and education of children with disabilities is based in the writing of Vygotsky, and he called it at that time defectology, and he made it in the 1920s. And we might say defectology, this terminology, is some old-fashioned and out of step with modern way of expressing oneself about the subject of disability. But I find that the ideas Vygotsky expressed in his defectology are still very fresh and they're still very relevant. The cultural historical understanding of disability is developed from its general developmental theoretical understanding and concepts about children and their learning and development. So an outline of the conceptual model of disability has to start out looking at key concepts of development in general as outlined in Vygotsky's work. The main idea of Vygotsky was to, in understanding development, was to conceptualize how learning and development is always situated in concrete historical and cultural practices. So the cultural historical development approach to understanding disability highlights that even though disability arises from one or more biological impairments, it is at all times necessary to understand disability as a phenomenon that emerges within particular physical and social and cultural historical contexts. Vygotsky outlined development as made up of two lines. The first is the natural line of development, which we could understand as the individual biological maturation. The second is the cultural line of development, which is understood as a process by which the child acquires knowledge and the ability to use cultural tools through its activities in social institutional practices. under normal circumstances, and this is what I try to show in my model, under normal circumstances, the natural and the cultural line of development, they support each other. And as an example, consider a child that is learning to read. Learning to read, of course, requires certain natural skills. You need to be able to see the letters, to visually analyze the letters, and to transform their graphical shape into the phonological sound and the meaning. However, learning to read is never just an individual activity. It is actually a heavily culturally supported and mediated activity. It is supported by materials such as learners' books and activities such as reading together with more experienced readers like the teacher or the parents. And through these activities, the natural and the cultural lines become intertwined. At first, the reading activity feels a little bit difficult for the child. But through this mediated activity, he or she comes to experience a new feeling of mastery in relation to letters and words and books. Vygotsky put it in this, it's not my model, it's the, I'm not really actually sure whether, I think he has made it actually. The child can go the direct way, like in the bottom line, going directly towards the task in using just the abilities, you can say the natural, biologically based abilities. But you can take the roundabout way, which is to go to the top of the triangle, use the culturally mediated signs and tools. And in doing this, like in the reading activity, it actually changed the structure of the cultural functions, of the cognitive functions. To take this example, at first, when you first encounter such figures, they might just seem like random patterns. But as you participate in activity where they are presented as certain shapes that has a certain meaning, and you are taught the meaning, you begin to see these figures in a new way. And you cannot go back again. It's not possible, at least for me, that has been taught in the alphabet on the left-hand side, to actually go back and just see these as non-random figures again. Forever my perceptual system has been changed from the natural biological system into the higher mental system, where it's actually been culturized. On the other hand, I haven't participated in activities that have taught me any of the figures on the right-hand side. So for me, they're just random pictures. I'm not even sure whether they're that different or it's some of the same figures, because I haven't been taught these. So it's not like a cultural tool for me at all. So you can, our perception of letter will forever transform our basic perceptual skill into higher mental functions. Now, consider a child that is hard of hearing in a mainstream class without any kind of adaptation. This child would have trouble hearing the teacher's instruction, and it would have trouble imitating the teacher's demonstration of how to pronounce letters like the one in the left-hand side. This example might seem very obvious, but there are many other types of developmental disabilities that can actually affect a child's ability to participate in the activity of learning to read. Brain lesions can affect the child's level of mental energy and its ability to pay attention for a longer period of time. Brain lesions such as these that cause cerebral palsy can actually affect the child's ability to analyze visual patterns, or it can cause lowered visual acuity that make normal print size too blurred to actually read. And across all the different types of abilities, the effect will be similar. The development of a secondary disability. We can say due to the biologically based impairment, the child becomes hindered in learning important cultural skill and developing higher mental function in one or more areas. not because the child is not able to learn. It is actually an important point of the cultural historical theory that the child, the ability to learn is intact. The problem arises because the organization of the learning and the developmental support is based in some cultural assumptions about how children function. And these assumptions become violated when the child has a biological impairment, one or more of them. So it is the mismatch between the current level of the individual child and all these mainstream cultural assumptions about what would be relevant demands and support for children that becomes violated. That's what the disability is. It's not in the social setting, it's not in the child alone, but in the incongruence between the two of them. Thus, the often problematic development of children with many types of disability, it arises and develops from this mismatch, this incongruence between these two sides. And this is what Vygotsky said about it. He said, the fundamental problem in a handicapped child's cultural development is inadequacy, the incongruence between his psychological structure and the structure of the cultural forms. What remains is a necessity of creating special cultural tools suitable to the psychological makeup of such a child, or of mastering common cultural forms with the help of special pedagogical methods, because the most important and decisive condition of cultural development, precisely the ability to use psychological tools, is still preserved in such children. So I think it's very clear, and for me it's very relevant consideration in relation to understanding disability. Thus, compensatory myth means, because compensation is often what is talked about in casework with children and adults with disability, compensatory means should not address the impairment alone, they should address the relation between the child and the structure of the cultural forms. From a cultural historical perspective, they should also address the child's developmental potential, like looking ahead, what is ahead, where do this child need to go, rather than just address the present impairment. But we need to do more than just look at the present time. We need to look at how development develops through time. We can say incongruence as a developmental challenge is also related to the chronological age of the child and what you could call social developmental trajectories, which I will talk a little bit more about. Childhood social institutions, such as family and daycare and school, they are based in a lot of goals about child development, and they have certain demands and expectations. And all of these are actually based in the chronological age of the child. The activities that goes on and are supported in childhood institutions are always organized to fit with this age-graded expectations. For example, in Denmark, a child begins daycare often in like a nursery around the age of 1 year. The social practices in such a nursery is organized around the expectation that the children are not able to move around on themselves, they're not able to eat alone, and the practices are organized according to these expectations. So there are enough adults to move the children around and to help them eat. However, later, at the time of kindergarten, at 3 years of age, the expectation has changed. Now it is expected that the children are able to move around on themselves. They are expected to be able to unpack their packed luggage, lunch by themselves. And there are less adults, and the activities are different in so many ways. So throughout history, you can say, the cultural practices and society's structures has merged with the natural line of children's development. Often, these age-graded demands are a little beyond what the children are actually able to do on their own. However, the presence of supportive adults and the way the activities are organized still enable the children actually to do something, to participate, and gradually acquire new skills and new competences, thereby by being able to participate in new and more advanced ways. This is a very short description of Vygotsky's probably most famous concept, the zone of proximal development. However, what happens if a child develops a bit slower than its peers, need more time to learn certain things? Remember, for example, the example of learning to read, which I stated as a socially supported learning process. Learning the letters and learning to read is actually learning a powerful cultural tool. It opens up possibilities to acquire a lot of new knowledge from books and for orienting yourself in a world that is full of letters and signs. It opens up for writing messages to your friends and a lot of other things. And as children become more skilled readers, the requirement to use reading in school changes. The reading child now begins to participate in the school in a new way. So falling behind, not becoming a reader or an efficient reader in the same pace as your other children, it becomes a problem as time and peers move on. And suddenly the activities supporting learning to read, they ceases and are substituted with new activities where it's actually expected that the children are able to read and understand what they read at a certain pace. So the incongruence might actually arise or increase over time just from being out of step with your peers and with the developmental pace of the peers. We can consider such cultural aid standards and the organization of demand and support as windows of social developmental opportunities. Thus, a child's developmental pathway through institutional practices is also a trajectory to different social developmental windows associated with certain types of possibilities, support and demand, some of which may actually disappear or change radically as the child moves on. As long as the child is able to develop along a mainstream developmental trajectory, this cultural historical opening and closing of social developmental windows will actually provide the child with relevant demands and opportunities. However, if a child follows an alternative developmental trajectory that is out of synchrony with the developmental windows, relevant peers and activities might not be that readily available. In the case of learning to read, the solution will often be to organize some other activities that support the development of reading skill in a separate room from the peers or something. It could be to provide the child with technological solutions, such as programs that read aloud to the child. However, at other times, the remediation or the roundabout way suitable for this particular child might not be just as readily available. A Norwegian study by Ytterhaus, Wendelbo, and Lundeborg explored the social participation of children. Oh. Yeah. These children had either learning difficulties, or they had impairments in mobility, or both. It was an interview study where they interviewed the parents, an interview and follow-up study, and the children were between 3 and 12 years of age. One of their main findings was of a social turning point that was related to the age of the children. Social turning points has been found earlier on, often associated with transitions, but this social turning point was not associated with any kind of institutional shift. But at this turning point, social participation became more difficult. For the children with learning difficulties, it was around the age of 8. And for the children with mobility impairments, it was around the age of 10. Before these ages, all the parents, not just the parents of the children with disabilities, but the whole class, whenever children had some play date, the parents were very much involved. They made the arrangement, they transferred the children, and maybe they were also involved while the activity was going on. However, around the age of 10 or 8 to 10, the parents of the mainstream children began withdrawing from these play dates and left it to the children themselves to arrange their play dates. And at that time, it became more difficult for the children with disabilities to participate because they still needed the support of their parents. However, still having the support of a parent in a play date did not longer seem as an age-appropriate way of engaging with your peers, and thus the children experience growing social exclusion. Also, the content of the play dates began changing around the age of 10. While it has earlier been mainly about play, suddenly some of the non-disabled peers started being more interested in lip gloss and trying life as a young person. And the children with learning difficulties hadn't developed this motive yet. So suddenly they found themselves without peers with the same interest as themselves. So you can say that it was a window of social opportunity that had begun to close because it didn't have any peers with the same interest, and it was no longer acceptable that your parent arranged your play date or drove you around to the play date, even though, for example, the children with mobility impairments still needed this physical help. So it's a central point of the cultural historical understanding of disability that in order to understand the incongruence, it is necessary to look at the relation between the individual impairment of the child and what are the conditions for social participation. And it should not be seen as distant elements in individual functioning and participation restrictions. It's actually altogether a qualitative uniqueness that rises from this situation of contradiction. However, in order to fully understand this contradiction, we need to include another important concept. It is the concept of motives. In the cultural historical understanding, motives are cultural historically formed interests and intentions. They arise out as cultural values of what is a good life according to us and what is appropriate development according to us. They are reflected in institutional practices. And as a child or everybody actually participate in this social institutions, these cultural values becomes conditions for our own development of motives. For example, this young woman, who is from a study I'm doing now, called her Emilia. She has severe cerebral palsy, and she has no verbal speech. Instead, she communicates with a gaze-controlled computer. You can see it on the picture. This gaze-controlled computer is actually a very good example of an alternative cultural tool that provides her, or has provided her all along, as a way to participate in the same learning activities as her peers. She has been mainstreamed all along, and through this mainstreaming and through this institutional organization according to the cultural value of inclusion, it has actually become her own motive that she wants to be included, that she wants a life as close or the same life as her peers. So this cultural value of inclusion is very much her own motive. However, all motives are multi-motivated. All activities are multi-motivated. So each child or each person develop one or more leading motives along with other motives. The specific motives are the result of former experiences, development in interest, and ideas about what you would like to do in the near future. For Emilia, at the verge of going to high school, the amount of work associated with being mainstreamed at the same conditions as her peer called for a new solution. Because she actually has a plan to become a science researcher, and participating in school and writing assignments with this gaze-controlled computer is more strenuous and it takes longer time. And Emilia intends to do well. She wants a good high school exam because, you know, otherwise she cannot get into university afterwards. So if she continued to follow the school at the same pace, at the same conditions as her peer, she would not have enough time for schoolwork, or she would be completely exhausted by the workload, or both. In this present social situation, the incongruence between her individual way of functioning with the gaze-controlled computer and the societal requirement to take a high school exam to go to university actually opened up for several different possibilities of how to solve this riddle. She could, it could be one example, she could take a specially adapted three-year high school. However, this exam would not, or this school would not provide her with the right exam to enable her to continue at university, so this was not an option. Another common solution could be to take her high school exam as single subjects, where she took a couple of subjects per year at an adult education center. However, this would take very long time to get her high school exam, and also it would actually deprive her of having a normal youth life where she belonged to a class with a group of peers. So this was not in line with one of her motives, which was to have be included and have a normal life. So the solution was to invent a third option that kind of balanced both of her leading motives, both the motive for inclusion and the motive for doing well in high school. By permission from the Ministry of Education, she was allowed to spend 5 years on a high school exam, 3 years in one class where she took less subjects than the whole class, and then she moved to a new class and took 2 more years where she finished the last subject. So thus, this social situation of development where she finds herself is a system of relation between the child's dominating motives on one side and then the social conditions for the child's development arising from cultural historical values and practices for demand and support of child development. All these three options would kind of try to compensate for her impairments. But the way Emilia chose to participate, the particular solution she ended up with, it arose from her particular social situation of development and her particular motives, rather than from the social conditions alone. We cannot just look at the social conditions. The last element in the cultural historical understanding is how the social situation of development and the contradiction between the child and the cultural form, they always evolve in cultural historical level, also at a higher level, we could say. To illustrate, I will tell you a little bit about another study. It was a study from Denmark that involved four families that together had 5 children with congenital deafness. This study took place in Denmark between 2005 and 2008, and it was during the introduction of cochlear implant technology. So the 5 children with congenital deafness was between 3 and 13 years of age, and they were followed for 3 years. The 2 oldest children received cochlear implantation at a time when they had already learned to use sign language as a main mode of communication. Both were assimilated into deaf community at that time. They were going to a deaf kindergarten and or deaf schools. So even though they actually gained this ability to hear by the cochlear implant, and they received supportive training in oral language, they continued to use sign language as a mean mode of communication. The social situation of development for the three youngest children were different in several crucial ways. They were all infants when they had the implants, and their main mode of communication became oral language. They did not join the deaf community. So both social situation gave rise to developmental incongruence, but of very different kind. The two older children faced challenges associated with being a minority using sign language in a society where all language is the norm. When they started school, they were enrolled in special schools for deaf and hard of hearing children. The younger children were met with demands of learning oral speech and challenges associated with inclusion in mainstream schools. They followed their local regular high school school programs. They participated in school life and relationships with friends with typical hearing, but they had some problems with hearing both in learning activities and in social activities. So this example illustrates two important points of a cultural historical understanding of disability. First, that it is a dialectical understanding. We can say the contradiction between the biologically based congenital hearing impairment and a mainstream culture of oral speech was resolved into a particular new social situation of development for all the children. Their similar congenital hearing impairment actually evolved into different incongruences and two qualitatively different kind of disabilities as their development went along. The primary biologically driven challenges give rise to developmental incongruence that impacted on the whole of their development. We saw the same in the situation with Emilia. Her motivated activity also resolved the contradiction into a new situation. The second point of the example with the children with congenital deafness was that the dialectical process did not rest on local microprocesses alone. The timing of the technological development in cochlear implants and the political decision to offer this type of advanced and expensive treatment to children with congenital deafness created different developmental trajectories for these children. So changes in societal values and recommendation of particular practices, it actually impact all the way down to social developmental opportunities, for example, the treatment of congenital deafness. It's also very obvious in the example with Emilia, where the decision to offer the Tobii technology as a means of communication is also very new, so her way of participating in school activities is also very different from how a woman like her would have participated 10 years ago. And in a global perspective, the resolution to any biological based impairment will depend very much on where in the world the child is born and where it moves through life. In real life practices, there is a need for this cultural, historical, dialectical disability model. And to illustrate, I will share another case from my study of a young man I met. In this study, the aim of the study is to look at the development of communication and independence in young people with severe cerebral palsy and no verbal speech. This young man I will call Frederick. Frederick is a lot more physically impaired than Emilia, and he cannot control a power wheelchair. He has always gone to special schools. When I met him at the age of 20, he was at a boarding school for an adapted high school education. He was also at the very beginning of developing active communication. Up until that point, he had been reliant on others to ask him the right question that he could then answer yes or give no answer with an eye blink. Frederick had encountered the biomedical model in many of his settings. The answer from the biomedical point of view had been that Frederick's lack of developmental progress was due to his congenital brain lesion and subsequent mental retardation. He was considered to have a mental age much below his chronological age. He was shown picture books for small children. He was repeatedly shown a picture of his mother and asked whether he could recognize her, blink one for a yes. And these activities did not lead to any noticeable development, and thus the biomedical model of him was used like considered confirmed. He is very mentally retarded. He had also encountered both the social model and the biopsychosocial model from the World Health Organization. The Danish welfare system is very much an expression of this point of view. His needs has been assessed. The special school was free. He was picked up and brought home every day by buses or taxis paid by the social welfare system. His parents has received compensation for loss of income due to his disability and his greater requirement for treatment, and because he was often needed more care in any way. Wheelchair and extra expenses for tube feeding was provided by the welfare system. However, despite all these compensations, their life had never been even close to the life of a normal family, and Frederick's life will never be near any mainstream life despite all these compensations. And I think Vygotsky expressed the difference in point of view very adequately in the next quotation, even though this text was written a long time before the biopsychosocial model was made. He says, if we subtract visual perception and all that relates to it from our psychology, the result of this subtraction will not be the psychology of a blind child. In the same way, the deaf child is not a normal child minus his hearing and speech. A child in each stage of his development, in each of his phases, represent a qualitative uniqueness, a specific organic and psychological structure. In precisely the same way, a handicapped child represent a qualitative, different, unique type of development. So the cultural historical understanding of disability, it's a conceptual model that provides us with analytical questions that are aimed at grasping how the different aspects of the social situation, such as the one of Frederick, they together create his unique social situation of development. So you can ask, what types of incongruences can we find in Frederick's social situation earlier and now? And how is his current situation related to previous and current resolution of incongruences? A main incongruence all along has been Frederick's lack of verbal speech in a social cultural setting where most activities are founded on speech or at least communication. His previous cultural form, his home setting, and the special school setting, the special teachers and other professionals did not have the knowledge and skill about how to support Frederick in learning a useful alternative way of communicating. And labeling Frederick as mentally retarded seemed rather than the resolution of this previous incongruence than as something that was real in him. A current incongruence at the time when he enters my study is between Frederick's, at that time, learned way of participating in communication. He's very passive in his way of communicating. He's waiting for others to take the initiative. But in this new setting, he's confronted with a new demand. The demand is he should actually express himself actively, and he is given a tool for this communication. It is a communication book after a particular system for alternative communication, which is either called the POD or the Pragmatic Organized Dynamic Display, which is actually an Australian invention. So now the incongruence has resolved into something else how to actually teach him, how to show him how to use this communication book for active communication. So what is Frederick's motive now? Frederick is actually beginning to build a motive to express himself, aided by his now current social support that shows him how this book works. So what is the social situation of development? It is a meeting between his motive now for learning to communicate with the pot system and the social conditions that contains exactly the needed type of demand and support for his learning that was lacking all along in his previous special schools. What type of roundabout pathways to higher mental function facilitate Frederick's learning and development? Well, the pot mediated communication is a very good example of a roundabout way to communication, and the gradual acquisition of more nuanced concepts for Frederick to begin to express his thoughts, feeling, and wishes. But it's also a roundabout way to more active social participation in learning activities in general and in social participation. Suddenly, he is able to express that he wanted to buy a present for his sister at her birthday, and much more. Thus, he's also developing a motive for participating in social settings in conventional ways, actually paying attention to how things should be done according to social costumes, and expressing that he wants to do this too. And the last question is, what types of opening or closing social developmental windows exist for Frederick in his present social situation? Well, around the age of 18 or a bit later, Frederick is considered as an adult, even though his development has been much delayed by his lack of an alternative communication system. Decisions about Frederick's life as an adult is about to be taken. And while some of the other young people in my study, for example, Emilia, was qualified for a particular welfare system offer where you can live independently in your own flat with around-the-clock helpers, it's not an option for Frederick because it requires one to be able to act as an employer. It requires one to have a very active sense of communication. It requires one to be able to plan your own day, what you want to do for a day or for a week, and Frederick has no experience with this. It's much too far from his current developmental level. So from his current placement at the boarding school, he will probably continue to an institution where he will live with other young person or adults like him, and it will be a much less independent life than if he had been able to live in a flat with his own helpers. Thank you.
Thank you, Louise. And we have time for a few questions, but we also have, we're online tonight as well, so Chantal might throw a few out. If you do have a question, I would like you to use the microphone, please, and I'm running up the back, and I'm trying to talk at the same time as if this is a non-interrupted form of communication. Thank you.
Thank you, and it's very interesting speech. I have two questions. You already mentioned that in the Vygotsky theory, Vygotsky mentioned that time and peers movement are critical for the disabled person. And I would like to know that what is the minimum time or interaction that can improve the motive of the disabled person? What is the minimum time level?
The meaning of time?
Yeah, minimum time. Minimum interruption time level.
Like the smallest, yeah. It's right that Vygotsky operated with several levels of time.
Yeah. I thought that it depends on a disabled person and its peer. But I want to know is that the common time is about, how can I say, the typical time for...
I'm not really sure I'm the right one to answer that question.
Okay. And
it's a difficult question, yeah.
Yeah, sorry for that. I have next questions. It's about that. Is that disabled person, the relationship between the disabled person and the supporter is the supporting person is depends on the gender. I mean, if the disabled person is a man, and if his supporter is a woman, if it is more, it may be quicker to improve, or the same sex.
So you're talking about whether the meaning of the gender of the supporting person?
Yep.
Yeah, of course it will add to the social situation of development depending on the person themselves. I guess that gender is always important, but I'm not sure I find it in the defectology it's mentioned explicitly, but I think it's a good point to be taken further and worked further into the understanding of disability from a cultural historical perspective. But I don't think it has a very prominent role in the writing as I've read it. But it's a good point.
Good, thank you very much for this evening. My name is John and I'm principal of a specialist school in Melbourne. I've been a long time admirer of Vygotsky, and he died at an early age of 37, but had done so much in those years. Would you like to reflect on, you know, I've always been motivated by unlocking the potential within, looking at the unique capacity for everybody to be a shining example, and encouraging teachers to know that maybe their student is their teacher, as opposed to they being their student's teacher. So you're using the word inclusion in a number of times and a couple of times saying that you know, Frederick would have been far better in a place because of his cognitive processing capacities to really be in a more stimulating environment than he was. Having said that, what would your reflections on inclusion be? What is the definition of inclusion to you in Vygotskyan terms?
As I read Vygotsky, he's not like necessarily talking only for inclusion. He's talking about the necessity of roundabout ways, but it could take place in a mainstream setting or in a specialized setting. And I think my answer would be the same, because some of the necessary adaptations, for example, in relation to some with severe cerebral palsy, are of such a kind that, well, depending on how creative you are, they can be difficult to carry out in a mainstream setting. So I'm not, like, I am not sure everybody can be and should be included, and I have no really definition of inclusion. I think it would be very difficult and maybe very courageous to start a definition of that.
Mine is that inclusion is a program, not a place. Simple as that. Thanks, John. We have an online one from Chantal.
Hi, Louise. I've got Timothy, who's joining us from Singapore. And he's just asking, how much time does it take to decide what sort of support is needed to provide for a person with a disability?
Sometimes, I at least know it takes too long time, because developmental time is valuable, and the longer time you spend trying to think about what this child needs or waiting for a solution to come up, at the same time, peers are moving on. So I don't think you can say there's a fixed time, but you need to take developmental time seriously, and often it's not. Often there's so much waiting time and time being lost, and it is important, developmental time, because suddenly they are 18 years of age and they're moving on to adulthood, no matter how they have been supported along.
Thanks. Jennifer Miles. I've come from a health sciences background, but I'm now in education. I fell in love with the social model back in 2000, and I'm devastated to hear you say that it's sort of lost its impact. But I love what I'm hearing here, and I'm interested in your thoughts about how well it's being integrated, how well it's being accepted and practiced in mainstream learning spaces, yeah.
But even Tom Shakespeare, who was one of the founders of the social model, has left it. But it doesn't mean it hasn't its impact. It's just it's being left as the only model. It still has important points. No doubt about it.
Penny Robinson from the School of Public Health and Preventive Medicine. So I've come from the Alfred to hear this talk. I have a question about what you think about Australia's National Disability Insurance Scheme. There's a bit of laughter in the room. It's being rolled out over several years, but some of my friends in the autism community have had such problems with the NDIS that when it comes to Bayside next year, I'm actually considering not enrolling at all because I can't be bothered with more paperwork.
I'm not really sure I know that much about the Australian system, but I know from all my research in families that what annoys them, even in Denmark, where a lot of things are free, it's still a bureaucratic system. And what they say is a strain on them as parents, it's not the child at all, it's the bureaucracy and the paperwork, definitely. So if we could get rid of that, it would be a great improvement. It would take half of the disability away because that's actually part of the disability.
I think that's a common theme here too. Yeah. Perhaps time for one more. Are there any more questions? Yes, over the other side. Thank you very much.
Hi, I am Fatima Tajuhra from Faculty of Education, and my research project is also inclusion of children with disabilities in early childhood level. So I'm very interested about your case, the Frederick, and you said that first he didn't initiate any communication. If someone initiated, then he responds by eye blinking. And later on, a device, maybe computer device or software provided, and then it changed the social situation of development or conditions. So why previously he was just communicating with eye blinking, and after giving the device, how he tried to use that, how did he learn to communicate with that device? Thank you.
It's a very good question, and it's a very large challenge actually to move such a young person as Frederick around. This problem with passive communication is a huge problem for Frederick and someone like him. It takes professional who actually believes in the child and believes exactly actually like we do with small children. We kind of interpretate their what they say, that and expect it to be meaningful, and often these persons are met the other way around. So if there's a little bit of confusion about what they say, it's like, oh, he's not saying anything. But you need instead to actually have confidence in the meaning. They are actually trying to express a meaning, even though it's not very clear for us. Then let's build this meaning together. And that's exactly what happened in the situation of Frederick. They were building meaning together, and he was supported as someone who was meaningful, and it enabled himself to experience himself as someone who had meaningful things to share with people around him. But it's a very emotional experience when you are so helpless as so dependent on your helpers and pedagogues as Frederick was. It's very emotional experience if, for example, to express that you don't agree with them on something.
It's very important that building the meaning together.
Yeah, they're building the meaning together.
Okay, thank you very much. On behalf of the faculty, I'd like to congratulate Louisa and thank her for coming and sharing her ideas and her time with us. And just before you start applauding, a couple of interesting things listening to Louisa today, and this is a very new field to me and my work. But it is interesting when you're challenged with ideas that cause you to stop and think and look again, you actually take away opportunities to challenge the status quo and hidden assumptions in your practice, your views and your ideas of life. And what Louisa has done personally for me tonight, and I
would assume from the audience by the leaning forward and the intent concentration on what's going on that the same has happened for you. You can't ask much more of a dean's lecture than to be drawn into the ideas, to have your ideas shaken up, and then to have them come out synthesised in a new form, in a new way, that help you move beyond where you were before. And Louise, you've done that beautifully tonight. Very much appreciated. Thank you very much for your time and energy.